I appreciate people coming out. People have questions, and anytime you got questions, it's always good that somebody is willing to listen and try to answer your questions, and I hope we can do that. We have Mary from No Pickens here. She's going to be videoing, so she keeps everything recorded and posted, so that's really good. And first thing I want to do is just basically bring everybody up to speed as to why this meeting was called. Now, we are, even though we're Board of Education, this is not an official Board of Education meeting. We just, I being board chair, Delane is the vice chair, we thought that it would be, you know, in good faith to come out and answer questions. And and like I said, to bring you up to speed as to why we wanted to get together several weeks ago, we started receiving some emails, and they were coming in to the school board, and they were basically identical in content, the emails were, and so when we start getting emails and they're basically the same thing, we know there's been some kind of collaborative effort, you know, that's a meeting or something's taking place, and everybody's wanting to get the same information. And so after the first few came in, I started sending out some contacts. You know, and basically, I put together a little reply, and I sent them out, you know, to the first few or the handful that was in the inbox. And then a few more came in, and we ended up with 10 or 12, and they were basically the same thing. And at that time, I started making some contacts by phone. To talk, you know, to physically talk to people then and find out, you know, tell me about it. Somebody's been in a meeting, obviously, for us all to get this information. And I don't know if I talked to anybody here or not. I talked to several by phone and had some good conversations. And most people are appreciative when you call them and say, hey, you know, tell me about your concerns and let me, you know, try to answer. So that was really good. And of course, when I had these people on the phone, you know, I asked them, you know, who can I contact to try to get people together if they have these, you know, concerns about education and stuff like that. So that it's much easier to get people like this and try to call people individual, or email is, you know, not as personal and people want to talk, and I like to talk to people too. So that's basically, they had gave me Ms. Williamson's contact name, and of course I've met with her, but with her before. And so we got this together, and so which is a good thing. So that's basically where we, you know, how this came to be today. Now we don't really have an agenda per se here, but what I do have is just sort of a platform of some things that, you know, that will take us through this meeting, and what I want to do first, and the emails basically that we were receiving was mostly in content about the employment and the contract of the previous superintendent. And to go ahead and let you know, Delane or myself, neither one was here during the writing of a contract, during the approval of a contract of our previous superintendent. Now we will be part of, you know, the contract and involved obviously in the contract of the superintendent that we will hire this spring at some point in time. We're in that process of searching now. So we will be. And that'll be the first time that we have been involved in a superintendent contract. Now, superintendents historically through the state of Georgia have about a 2.5 year stay at place, and which is tough, you know, because that's a, you know, you get somebody in place and then within 2.5 years, average 2.5 years, now you might have some districts where they last longer than that, but you want them to stay longer for good, but you know that 2.5 years is historically the length of term that a superintendent stays, which is not long. So as far as platform, first thing we're going to do is basically introduce ourselves and tell you a bit about ourselves so that you'll know who we are. And board members, although we have districts that, you know, on paper we represent certain districts. We are representatives, or we're board members for everybody, all of the county. Every person in here votes for every school board member, regardless of where in the county that person resides. But we do have to reside within the broken up districts, within the school district. And I'm in the northwest area of Pickens County. Delane is in the, I don't even know what my number is. I think my number's two or one. I don't know what my number is. It's not your five.
I think I'm most of these things.
But we're board members for everybody in the county, regardless of where we live. So we'll tell you a little bit about ourselves, and then next, Ms. Lewis is going to explain how our school system is accountable and how it's measured by the state. You know, by the state constitution, and of course, there's laws, and we can talk about laws, you know, all night about what dictates what happens within a school district and what we have to go by. And she's going to have some information here that tells the accountability that Pickens County Schools is to the state of Georgia and what we have to look to. Now, and we can talk about what this county does as far as how they handle school stuff. Every county is different, and we are voted on in this county, and we're responsible for Pickens County Schools. And although we do our homework, trying to look at what other districts do as far as how things are handled, you know, it's always good to look in other areas. But we're responsible for Pickens County Schools, and that's what we are elected to do, and that's what we are going to be held accountable for. Where they're going to explain some of the roles and responsibilities of the board. This is always missed, perceived very much about what the Board of Education does and what a superintendent does. And there's some team play in there, and then there is some division there as far as what legally, by state law, not by what we want to be, but by the state law that says board members do this, school superintendents do this. And as we talk about those things, the reason we're going to talk about them is because we're going to lead up to, you know, what we're going to be looking at and why we're going to be looking at certain things as we go through our superintendent search. So that's basically roles and responsibilities. And then we're going to discuss some of the statistics of our school system. And it's just going to be some highlights of different things there that, you know, will draw some attention to you for sure as far as our school. And then we're going to begin to answer your specific questions, because the questions that, you know, we were getting by email were very specific questions. And we want to make sure that because of those emails we were getting, that we answer those questions for you. At least to the best of our ability, that's what our main focus is going to be. And because this stemmed from the superintendent and what we're going to be doing with the new superintendent, you know, that's where these questions, you know, we're going to try to keep those questions to education, because that's what we are. We're Board of Education, and that's where we want to keep those. And does that sound agreeable, you know, that we do that? So out of us, is it safe to say that you would expect us to answer as many questions as we can, and if we can't find an answer, then we'll talk to you one-on-one, and we will try to come up with an answer, and then it becomes a much easier process. If this person has a question we can answer, then we will try to get back to you personally and make sure the questions are answered. Okay, so if everybody's in agreement with that, the next thing basically is something that we would expect out of you as coming out to doing this. When we started getting our emails, the emails were tons of capital letters and tons of exclamation points. So that normally tells you what the person's feeling when they email, you know. So that, and it was pretty much across the board. Now, some was that way, but the majority were. So when you see in these capital letters and all these exclamation points in places that you probably wouldn't even expect to see them, you sort of know that some, you know, people are emotional or passionate about what they're asking. So because of that, for us, what we would expect is, don't start yelling at us, you know, don't yell at us. And we want to make sure that, you know, we keep this on a professional level. And we will be very respectful on both sides, and we want to make sure you leave here with your questions answered. That's what our goal is. All right, so I'm going to start out, I'm going to tell you a little bit about me. And I promise this is not an election, please vote for me kind of speech, because this is not a position that I can tell you I'm going to go out and try to vote, get people to vote for me again for. This is a tough, tough position. And you can always say, and I believe that it's true, that people running for a position that is a non-paid, now we do get paid $100 a meeting. This is not a meeting. We're not getting paid here. We're not here collecting $100, I promise. But people have reasons for running for something, you know. And I'm going to tell you mine. I was born here in this county. and I've lived here my entire life. So I've known this county from 1970 all the way up to current. And I went to through the Pickens County school systems, of course, and then actually in this school right here, I came here as a high school student from the high school and started taking classes here. And in the 80s when I was coming here, and of course we have a retired Pickens Tech instructor over here who he was here teaching when I came here, which we knew that. And he was a teacher here, and it was a big deal. This school here was a big deal in the 80s as far as training people for jobs. It was huge here. And so the tons of people came from the high school, and I was one of those people who started in the 10th grade and was able to come over here for a couple of hours a day, you know, through 10th through 11th, and then was able to come here as a full-time senior and didn't even have to go to my high school. The academic classes that I had to have to graduate was taught here. So I was a full-time senior here and still getting credit for my high school. And ended up graduating in 1988 from both places with a diploma from here. Upon graduation, you know, I was 18 years old and had a diploma from here and my high school diploma. I began working for Bill Elliott Racing, and because I took the auto collision repair program here and painting, so I got a job directly out of here, and then I continued my career basically in the program that I came here as a 10th grader for. So that's an automotive industry is all I've done, and then I came here and started teaching 10 years ago. I've been here 10 years now, and I teach it. And when I came here, being from this county and being a product of that dual enrollment process that I just described, I was expecting to see tons of kids, you know, because the growth here has you know, there's more kids here now than there were in the 80s, but there was a lot less kids coming here getting technically trained, you know, during that time. So I started, you know, I was really concerned because I'm one of those kids. I'm a product of that, of what I was referring to. And so I started going out visiting high schools, trying to figure out why is high schools not supporting this? Why are these kids not coming here? Because we all know not everybody's going to universities. That's not going to happen. Now, I'm a big supporter of kids going to universities, but I'm a supporter of every kid getting something that will benefit them when they get out of high school. So, or even while they're in high school, because a lot of times it's too late when they get out of high school. They've already set down a path, and you may not ever get them. So I like it, getting them early and getting them into something that's going to benefit them in life. So that was me, and I just didn't feel like I was getting any ground visiting high schools and just being an instructor here. So I started, you know, contemplating on it. I thought, well, if I was on that Board of Education, I could make something happen, you know, and I thought I could make stuff happen. And it has been a much slower process because even on the Board of Education, when you see that there's things that need to be done or things that need to happen, we're so restricted in what we can do many times by law, you know, that we can't say any things. And before I was on the board, I could speak louder than I can now while I'm on the board in certain areas. But that right there in itself is the reason that I'm on the Board of Education. So if you say people have an agenda, you've just heard my agenda. That's why I ran for the Board of Education. And by doing that, you know, I'm very active outside my house. And it's a sacrifice. You sacrifice a lot of time away from things to be on the Board of Education. But I knew that what I wanted to do or what I was going to try to do as a board member was a worthwhile for our community. I feel, and I still feel it today. And if I'm on the board two more years, because I'm halfway through now, if I'm on two more years or six more years or whatever it might be, I'm going to continue trying to work on that area. That is my area that I got on the board for. So that's me right there. I'm going to turn it over to Delane. She'll tell about herself, and then she's going to get into some of this other area.
And I will be brief. Unlike Daniel, I was not born in 1970. I was born in 1947, which makes me year two of the baby boomer generation. My husband turns 78 this year and I turned 70, so I think I'm probably a lot more on the same page as most of the folks in this room. I appreciate y'all being here tonight. It's an absolutely gorgeous afternoon. I'm sure it was hard to pull yourself away from whatever it was that you were doing before you came. I had two careers. By the time Danny was born, I had already taught my first year of U.S. history. And so then I taught for a few years, and then I went to work for an airline, and I worked there for 20 years, and then took an early retirement package from Delta, and most of you know that the airline I worked for isn't in business anymore because we went bankrupt. So with that bankruptcy, had my husband's pension from Delta Airlines as well. We both needed to look for something else to do. So actually, he came here and taught, and I went back into the Pickens school system and started working as a counselor, which is what I had done previously. We were very fortunate to be able to be in such a wonderful community, and by being involved in the community professionally, as well as just living here, I have come to appreciate what an absolute blessing it is to be in this environment. And so when I retired yet again, I looked at the Board of Education position that represents probably most of you, because I'm District 5, that's Bentry, Big Canoe, Marble Hill, that whole area down in there. And I did that because I have a real strong belief in public education and what it means to our democracy and what it means to our society. And so I know that we have a vested interest for all of us in what happens in our public school systems. But the other reason I did it is because my maiden name is McAllister. And for those of you who don't recognize the Scottish heritage there, I was raised by a real Penn daddy who taught me that you absolutely don't spend money unnecessarily. And so I came into this position with the hopes of being able to impact what I think most of you are here about, which is what your bottom dollar line is. My hand shakes just as much as yours probably does every time I have to pull money out of a savings account to write out that tax check, when I know, like most of you, that there's no way to replace that money in my savings account. And I know that not only did I remove the money out of savings, I also cannot replace the income that that money was generating. So I have a total respect for the tax dollars that you are contributing to the school system. And while you will learn through the course of our conversation that there are many times when we can't impact this in the way that you would like for us to, I want to assure you that I am doing everything I can to keep that tax bill as low as I possibly can. We were able to reduce the millage rate just a little bit this year for your school taxes. I think that kind of got lost in the shuffle, because at the same time we lowered it, the county raised theirs. So you probably didn't see any difference in your tax bill, but please know that we are trying. With that, I want to kind of focus on what brought us here all together, which is that superintendent position. And while I've got my Scottish daddy with his penny pension way, I've got my mother who always taught me that you get what you pay for. And so we have to be very careful about how we balance what's going on. And I want to explain, it's just a short rabbit trail, but I want to take you down just a little bit of a rabbit trail right now about what happened with funding for public schools in Georgia, because it does impact the decisions that we're getting ready to make. In 2005, there was a Quality-Based Education Act that was passed by the state of Georgia. With that, it included the funding formula for how the public schools were going to get their money, but it also set some requirements for how that money had to be spent and what requirements you had to meet in terms of class size, teacher education, those kinds of things, that put it all together. The state of Georgia has a balanced budget constitutional requirement. And so when the state coffers started emptying out, what they did was they pushed down the state portion of what was being contributed to the school systems, and the local school systems had to pick up the difference. Now, in order to make that a little more palatable, what they did was they came up with this thing called waivers. And so they allowed us to apply through a long process. They allowed us to apply to relieve ourselves from some of those requirements, like class size, for example, and some other things, so that our local dollars could pay a little bit better
for what we were required to do. Well, as state budgets have raised, we have been getting a little bit more money from the state. That has something to do with the reason we were able to give you almost a mil back in your taxes. But we're not there yet. And so what the state did to kind of continue that process of allowing us to be a little bit more flexible was they required us to sign a contract with the state. And it's called a strategic waiver contract. So we as a school board spent a lot of time researching and digging and trying to figure out exactly what that meant to us locally. So starting this year, we are under contract with the state. Now, how that impacts you is that because with that contract to allow us to operate more fiscally, with more fiscal restraint, we also have to meet certain accountability measures in terms of student performance. And so we have an obligation to ensure that our students make 3% per year progress, and it's based on academics and attendance, and there's several other factors in there, and if y'all have specific questions about that, I'll go into it in a lot more detail. But basically, if we don't meet the benchmarks that are contracted from the state, we have to hand our school system over to the state. Now, handing our school system over also implies handing our local dollars over to the state. And so we are quite nervous about this because it's new for everybody. Now, I know that y'all know that there was a constitutional amendment to allow that. That was defeated last year, and thank you very much for those of you who voted against it. The reason we were so against it is because there's already a mechanism in place for that to happen. The constitutional amendment even took more control, but this has a potential for significant impact on us. And so as we are looking for our superintendent, we want to make sure that we've got somebody who's got the management skills to be able to get our students and our school system moving forward at the same rate we're moving forward now. We've made massive progress in the last year or two with how our school is doing with regards to, it's called the CCRPI, stands for College and Career Readiness Performance Indicators, which is basically test scores. Test scores, graduation rate, and I know that y'all have all seen us flaunting our graduation rate because we're so proud of it. It's 94.something%, and we're 19th in the state with our graduation rate. So
14th in
the state. We are so excited about that, but we're also excited about the fact that we've made really, really good improvement in some places. We've got to make sure that the person that we bring in continues that growth. And so with that said, that's what we want y'all to understand, that as we are negotiating. The other thing I want to say, which Daniel already alluded to, we were not on board when Dr. Perry's contract was signed. Neither one of us would have voted for that contract. So we want you to know that we will be trying to protect every painful tax dollar that you pay when we negotiate this next contract. But we do want you to understand that we've got some provisions in there that we have to meet in order to get the person that we want.
Okay. All right. I'm gonna go now into some of the roles and responsibilities and how we have to act and what we can do and what's expected of us. Most people, when you elect somebody, and of course I was right there, I got out and I talked to people, you know, when I was running for the board, and you say you want to do this and you want to do that. And I basically said what I said a while ago. That's it. That is the platform I ran on. I didn't say I'm going to cut your taxes. I didn't say, you know, so because who knows? I don't know that. And I didn't know it then. And I try now to do, I'm very fiscally responsible. I try to be. But I'm not telling people stuff that I don't know for certain, you know. But the as a school board member, in 2010, there was a Senate Bill 84 that was passed. And what it done is it basically really put together a package that said school boards do this, superintendents do this. And then in this gray area in the middle, you're sort of a team. You know, it's a team approach. And anybody that's been on the board or is currently on the board will tell you a lot of times it is very touchy areas that you get into, because if we step into day-to-day operations you know, we can get, the superintendent can sue us. You know, there's legal ramifications for it. And we, when we are sworn into this position, we put our hands on that Bible and we swear to uphold the state of the Constitution and the laws. And sometimes laws are not in agreement with us, but we swear to uphold them, and we don't want to get personally in trouble because we break a law. It's breaking a law is what it is if we step out of bounds. So even though, and of course, within that definition of what boards do, what superintendents do, and I could talk huge about it, there's a big list of stuff, but to keep it short and on track with what we're talking about tonight, one of those things is like a code of ethics that we have to have. We have it in our policy. You see it on the policy, on our school website, under policies, and it's going to be a policy in regards to code of ethics. And it is strictly because if a law is passed that affects us, we have to create a policy saying that Pickens County Schools are doing this, and the reason is that's the law, and we have to make it into a policy at that point. So you can see the code of ethics on there and see what we have to do. But one statement in there, this is not verbatim, so I short it down a little bit, but even though we hire that superintendent, the board does not undermine the authority that is legally given to the local superintendent. Now, I was born in this county, and if you ask me if I know what's best for this county, I can say, yeah, I do. And I can hire a superintendent, and I can't tell him how to run the school once I hire them. They become contracted, and by law, I cannot undermine that superintendent. And when I said I know what's right for this county, I'm just joking with that. But, you know, I feel strongly a lot of times about my county. And if I think something's not going in the right direction, I by nature want to say, I don't think this is best for our county. But by law, you know, I can't go in and tell that superintendent, you know, what to do. Because those responsibilities do belong to the local superintendent and the school administration. And that is the day-to-day operations that we do not get involved in. We cannot by law. Okay, now it's very easy to say, all right, well, what does the school board do? All right, if any one of you, just like out here today, you know, if you've got questions, I'm going to try to answer your questions. Or if you've got a grandchild and you're having trouble in a particular person's class and multiple people are talking about a teacher, and you call me because you've met me or you know me, then I'm going to listen to your concern, and then I'm not going to talk to that teacher. That is completely out of my jurisdiction as a school board member. I'm going to go to my superintendent, and if I've got a good relationship with my superintendent, and which we should, then they're going to see that this is handled because that's their responsibility. And now you may say, well, I'm going to call you if it don't get fixed, and I'm going to say, absolutely, do that. And then I'll go back to the superintendent again. So I want to make sure things are, you know, going, and that's the responsibility that all of us have as board members. So we could go on and on about the separation, but I think I'm getting the point across that we don't run the school, and we can create policy, and we do that. And a lot of, like I say, 90%, I don't know if we have even implemented a policy that came locally. Every policy that I've been involved in the past 2 years is because state law just passed, and now you've got to create a policy saying that you're doing it locally, and it's basically filling in. They're just like blanks left, and you put in Pickens County, and the policy's already basically written for you. And that's what we get into. All right, along with that, during that time, and this goes back to a little bit of what she was saying as far as our accountability, that when they passed that Senate bill, it gave the governor power to intervene when a school district is at risk of losing accreditation. All right, so that's already in place. That's been in place, and I fully understand that. If a school is truly a failing school, somebody needs to be able to come in and say, we got to do something. And that's a little bit different about what the, you know, the constitutional amendment that was up for vote last fall. A little bit different than that. So this has been in place and it's still in place, and there's measures in place that the state of Georgia could come in. If we are failing school, they could come in and they can bring people in here and they can start making adjustments, and they have the legal ability to do that. When that happens, your local school board is pretty much having to stand back and watch it take place. And that's, you know, we're out at that point. And of course, it can even get deeper than that. It can get much deeper. And whether you voted for that amendment or not, I chose not to vote for it. And the reason being is I'm not saying that it might not benefit somebody else, some other school district. I'm here to represent this school district, and I happen to believe that in a worst-case scenario, if they were to take over our schools, you would not have the ability right here. You would not have a local board that's going to come out and talk to you about an issue. You're going to have to call Atlanta and talk to some generic overseer, and I'm just speculating here at what potentially could. But we looked at these things very, very hard at what potentially could happen locally. And she was right that you would give up local, your dollars would leave or could leave. And I believe that it is in the best interest of this county to always protect, whether you like your board or don't like your board. If I hope that at any given time you would have somebody on your board that would come and talk to you. And I'd never want to see a county lose that ability to speak to a person that potentially can have, you know, that can have an impact. And people's opinion. People will say, well, you know, if I don't talk to them, they'll not do any good. I promise you, when you talk to the board member, or I'm going to use myself as an example here. If you talk to me and you tell me an issue, I don't forget your issue. If it comes up in a situation to where we do have the ability to make a comment or something, it is our responsibility to let the superintendent know, you know, the county don't like this program that's going on in school or whatever. So we hear and we listen and we take it to the level that we can take it to. So it's not forgotten. And I wouldn't just come out here and talk and listen to you if I didn't think that it has some impact. You know, I want to make sure that we communicate with people, especially when you get large groups of people and they have concerns. Somebody needs to go talk to them and answer their questions and try to relieve some of the concerns they have. And this is just going to give us some, and what I'm going to do here is I just got some quick numbers, and I sent this out by email to a few people. She already hit on some of this stuff. We have a $43 million budget, 4,406 students that we currently have in our school district, and she talked about the graduation rate of 94.2. The state's graduation rate, the average in the state of Georgia is 79.2, and we have 94.2. So that's a huge difference in graduation rate. So that is something to be proud of. We have 680 employees. The actual number is 589, but I just called it 600. And she talked about the school millage rate going down. And I don't know if you did you. Excuse me if you did talk about this, but the QBE that basically is taken out of our budget every year.
I did not get to that.
Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I'm waiting for everybody's blood pressure medication to kick in.
Yes. Oh, I forgot to take mine.
Because this is going to get you if you didn't already do that. The way that QBE money comes from the state, the funding money, there's something called equalization that is a piece of that. What happens is everybody sends their tax money down to Atlanta. Atlanta plays monopoly with it, I guess. I don't know what they're doing. And then they send us back what they make. I have, for those of you after you, afterwards, I didn't know how to print copies of this or send it around because we had no idea how many people were coming. But our portion, which Atlanta takes from us and does not give back, is $6,529,000, $529,210. That's 659,210. That's our local tax dollars, your property tax money, the state of Georgia keeps. And they distribute that to other counties throughout the county, out throughout the state. Now, the logic behind that is that they try to decide which counties are wealthy and take our money and give it to some counties that are not so wealthy. But for those of you who want to look down this list, you might find some of these counties that they consider not so wealthy to be a pretty bit infuriating.
They consider us wealthy.
That's what I was getting ready to say. We are a tier four wealthiest county. They base that on per capita income and our property values in the county. So
that's not earned income. They don't base it. No. Earned income is only like $35,000. Mm-hmm. And the people in these upscale subdivisions raise it up to $55,000.
So that is one of the reasons that it makes us difficult, it makes it difficult for us to do some of the things that we would like to see done with our local taxes, because that quality-based education is called local fair share. Our local fair
that
share.
That sounds like an Obama liberal crap.
That's been around a long time. It was around before.
That actually was passed in 1985, and it's called the Quality Basic Education Act, and it specified that the funding of education was a shared responsibility between the state and local communities.
What is a shared? You know what I'm saying?
You know exactly what you're saying.
All of us here, okay, we're all seniors, pretty much all seniors. We work all our lives, okay? Me, individually, be 69 years old next month, and I've never had a child, but I paid school tax for at least 45 years, 14 up here. And now to find out that the money, tax money that I'm paying doesn't even stay in this county. That's not right. Now, I don't know if that's a law or whatever else. If it is, it needs to be changed.
That's definitely a law.
It's definitely a law.
So that $6.5 million leaves the county.
I mean, $6 million for this. There's only one high school. There's two middle schools and four elementary schools here.
It's five mills.
Well, I mean, so what is the school board?
We have no control.
Well, I mean, there's got to be somebody you can talk to.
Rick Jaspers would be a guy.
It is the most frustrating thing to look at.
I don't know what my problem is with my tax bill. How do we get that tier changed?
That's a question that's not school board.
The next census, everybody don't put income, put zero.
Okay, I moved into this county about a year and a half ago. By the way, Daniel, when you were born, I had already paid 15 years of school taxes. And when you were born, I was in high school. Because I look around, most of these people are a lot younger than I am. So I've got a bigger bone to pick than most of them. But what my question to you is, since most of the counties, or so many of the counties surrounding us, eliminate the school tax from a senior, by having to collect the tax here from the seniors, that gives you a larger net worth, or it gives you a larger pool of money. No wonder the damn QBE is coming in here and taking that money. They're taking our money.
That's right.
And that's where I get disturbed.
I'm right there with you.
My big question is, why do you have to hire a school superintendent from out of the county? They have no vested interest in this county. They don't really care. They do their job, but they don't really care. If they lived here as a permanent resident, then they would care. Why do you have to hire somebody out of county?
Okay, that doesn't make any sense. You're saying we have to hire somebody out of county.
Well, you're considering it, aren't you?
Absolutely, yeah. We're considering. This is what we have to look at. Whoever we get in here, whoever we hire, is going to have to fulfill this contract that is required. Now, this is not, we didn't choose to do this. It was required that we write a contract with the state of Georgia. Every school district in the state of Georgia did this. And this was passed in 2008. And then it wasn't until 2015 that the deadline actually came. And of course, we were involved during the, we went right to the deadline and before we did this, some school districts have been doing it for a while. We have to meet these criteria.
But there are a lot of good educators in this county. Some of them are retired that could be hired. I've called around to the other counties. Their superintendent is permanent residence. They have a vested interest in their county.
Well, we have not ruled out anybody. Yeah. And as a matter of fact, what we did in this search process is you're going to get people from who knows where. you know, that.
But can't you make it a requirement that they live in this county and not give them a house in Ventry?
Well, there's no place that says we have to give anybody a house either. That, you know, what you're saying is based on a contract in the past, and there's no way I can speak for what a board previous to me.
So you're saying that you won't do that again?
You're talking to individual board members here. We are not here speaking as a whole board. We are speaking as individual board members. I do not ever want to see a contract that is as busy as what the contract you referred to, because I couldn't understand.
Is a state required to have a superintendent?
Yes.
We have to have a superintendent.
Now,
absolutely.
Once that superintendent, from what I'm hearing, signs that contract, she has total control. You cannot do anything, and if you do something that upsets her, she could turn around and sue you.
And I make that sound extreme.
But
it is a team. I mean, you want it to be a team, but when it's a contract involved.
Why isn't the power half and half? She has a vote along with the school board.
Yeah.
So it's not full power to her.
She or he does not get a vote on any policy or financial matter. They have some discretionary spending allotments, but anything that's major, that is approved by the board, but the board as a whole, not as us individually. I think what Daniel's saying is that we're representing ourselves right now. We're not representing the board as a whole.
Right, I understand that.
And the contract as presented to us at the time will be negotiated with whoever that individual is that we see rise to the top of the applicant pool. The applications close February 28th.
But will take it into consideration.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, our tax dollars probably paid it. Lula may pay an extra 90-something $1,000, including
it. I have no idea.
Yeah.
Why isn't it public information? Why is it put behind closed doors?
What's that?
The contract.
It's not.
How can we just find out about it? Nobody knew that she was getting paid all this for 3.5 years.
It's
right.
Not.
Nobody knew until somebody inside told me about it.
Yeah, it's a public document. And all salaries of any person hired by the Board of Education in the school system, all of that is available on Georgia.gov.
Open Georgia.
Before you get too far down that rabbit trail, going back to that document that you have about us being a four-tier county and money goes to underprivileged counties, I'd like to know if Cherokee, Gilmer, Cobb, Dawson get funding that would be appropriated from us to them.
It's a little bit more complicated than that in the way the figures go, but essentially Cherokee, they take from Cherokee and that 5 mils, Cherokee gets, I'm just going to round these off, okay?
Okay.
They give 36 million plus. What they get back from that formula is 2 million. So they are getting back a portion of what they send. Cobb sends down 132 million, they get none back. Gilmer sends down 5.6 million, they get none back. And what other county did you ask me about?
Dawson
is another one. Dawson sends back 5.5 mils, they get nothing back.
But you notice they all have a senior tax exemption.
Yeah.
And truthfully, you know, from a financial standpoint, we don't have the industry support. So I'm
just curious, what does the superintendent make? What's his salary?
The superintendent's salary is going to be a negotiable item.
What was it last year?
The contract was very complicated. It was complicated. Overall, it was $120,000 is what. Now, I'm not talking about the housing that you're talking about. I did have this was a big question here, is cell phone and car. And of course, I'm very quickly going to defend that, because these people, like right now, if I need to call our superintendent, I'm going to get a hold of that superintendent like this. or in the middle of the night or on Saturday. These people truly are at call all times. And just like any business, you know, if you're working for a company, you're going to have a phone, especially if you're expected to be there on call for 24 hours a day. They truly are. And because I work through the day, and if you give me a concern, I may not get it to that superintendent through the day. So they're going to be on the phone with me at, you know, I'm here on Monday and Tuesday until 9 o'clock at night. So it's going to be 9:30 before I even get to talk to them. So the telephone, and we don't give them a phone. We don't say, here, you know, Merry Christmas, this is your phone. These phones are owned by the school, and they're issued to that person. And the phone that Dr. Perry had, our interim superintendent has that phone. And in the same way with the car, these people are going, they're going continuously from school to school, and they're not, I don't expect them to use their personal car to do school business. And the phone, the car that they have currently is a car, I forget that, it's got 100,000 miles on it now, and of course we do have some other cars within our fleet, and we're going to have to purchase another car at some point in time, and probably when we do, we would probably want the superintendent to have the newer vehicle, and because it's going to be on the road much more than what the we need the car for some other areas in our school.
What about the county pumps, the gas? Do they get paid gas? Do they have a card where they get free gas? Fill up?
For school use.
Yeah.
For school use.
Yeah. It would be cheaper just to put them on a mileage.
Yeah, and you could, that's an negotiable thing, too.
Yeah, you know, you've got insurance, you got all these other things.
That would be a very negotiable item based on the person. I personally like my personal car because I keep all my stuff in it, and I'd have a hard time even on a job, especially if I'm within the county. I would say, just pay me and let me keep my stuff in my vehicle so I'm not trying to. But that you may find people that's the other way around. They wreck the car, they'd much rather wreck your car than theirs. So it's a negotiable type situation, and it's sort of a balancing act as far as what saves you the most money. You know, it's a touchy area. It can go both ways right there as far as, but I don't see that it's so heavy one-sided that it would make a bunch of difference, you know. Let me get these sort of in line. I'm trying to keep them in how I first see them.
Okay. You said a while ago that you could not tell the superintendent what to do. Who does?
Okay. Here's what I say when I mean that. We have what's called a strategic plan, and we have to have a strategic plan. And this strategic plan lays out guidelines of what you want schools and businesses have strategic plans. It's guidelined out with the majority of it basically fulfilling, you know, what's in these contracts and things like it. When you have to meet certain criteria, that's in your strategic plan.
That he does these things?
Well, that's us. There is a superintendent evaluation. And the superintendent evaluation primarily is on the strategic plan. So everything that we as a school board, and your strategic planning, there's people from the community, you know, come in and sit in on, they're broken up sort of in different groups based on different criteria. And they make comments about, well, I wish our school district was doing this. And a lot of times that stuff's implemented, but it has to still fall within all of our regulations. So that in a sense, because we have that evaluation, and we have to go through that evaluation process once a year with the superintendent. So it's sort of a grading schedule. If they're weak in an area, we have the ability then as a board.
But you don't want to wait a year to tell somebody.
Now we can set it up. We can set it up to where you're doing it in a 3 month or 6 month. But you can do it we have to do it by law every year. But we can choose to do it every 3 months if we wanted to. And of course, if I've got a concern, she's going to know or he's going to know my concern now. If I hear a concern, I'm on the phone on my way home. But let me tell you what's going on or what I'm hearing. And that lets them know, you know. And if they get a consensus across the board, if everybody on the board's coming to Colin said, this ain't working, whatever's happening here in this area is not working, then that gives them the ability to make some adjustments. But we still have the superintendent evaluation in place, and that is what they're evaluated by. So as we get ready to hire a superintendent, we want to make sure this evaluation is very to the point, there's no question, the main part of it is going to have to come from what the state of Georgia is holding us to. So that, we do employ those people, but now we're on that fine line, you know, that I discussed, and you can see it's a fuzzy line, and it's fuzzy for us too, because we get in situations where we may say too much sometimes, and then you get thinking, uh-oh, you know, is she going to contact somebody or he? And I'm not saying this has happened, I'm just saying this is can happen very easily. When you have five people on a board, and you can imagine, you know, five people, how many times do five people always agree? It's hard. It's hard to come to consensus a lot of times. And you know, one will have a strong feeling one way and another have a feeling another way. And let me get some of these other people that were already
here. And I would just make one comment, Attorney Sherman, before you go. We have hiring authority. So the flip side of that is, but were we to fire a superintendent mid-contract, we may have some pretty stiff financial repercussions.
I just couldn't understand.
Yeah.
When you said, hey, we're not the boss of him, boss.
That's why we have to choose somebody that we feel is professional, that can do what they have to do. That's the key part, because we are not telling. I teach auto collision. I can't tell the superintendent how to run the school and how to make grades, you know, this grade level's reading scores go up. I can't tell them that by no means. But I know that if that's a requirement here, I can hold them accountable for doing that. So that does create a boss situation, but it's not, because you can still see the funny line. It's complicated in a sense, and it takes a lot of training. I mean, we spend so many hours in training, because I look for that line. I look to see how close I can get, because I'm very vocal. If something's going on, I'm going to be there speaking on it, but I got to be cautious, you know, not to break that line. Let me get this lady out here.
All right. You've answered enough. I just have to take it further, so that's okay.
You ask it if you want to answer, because I came here to make sure everybody's answering.
Can I deal back to the tax for a moment? Mm-hmm. Do we have any information as to how many senior property owners live in Pickens County, and how much revenue by eliminating the school tax that will reduce your budget by?
We would love to have that information.
Where do we
have that information?
Well, no, Chief.
We don't have that. That's not within us. And when we, you know, when I first came on board and I was seeing the ad in the newspaper every week about don't buy property in Pickens County, y'all know what I'm talking about. I seen it, but that's not my responsibility. If you voted for me, you didn't vote for me based on whether or not a group of people or individuals are exempt from taxes. That is not what the school board does. By the Constitution of the state of Georgia, now, I am responsible for protecting the tax dollars as they are in the budget, and that's what I do. We do that. We came in and the budget was what it was during that time, and you know, it didn't start up fresh, but it was what it was. So we start looking, and she and I came on together. So we were very adamant when going through the budget meetings about looking at every line and seeing, you know, and questioning, you know, is this as it should be? Is that how it should be? We spend, I don't know how many hours we spend looking at budget stuff, but the taxes, we are not tax assessors, nor, that's not us. That's not what we do.
My last email from Mr. Jones, our commissioner, he told me there was, you get a tax break if you make $128,000 a year. Or 25. Oh, okay. But there's only 700 people that take advantage of that. So 700 people are at the poverty line. And so we make just a little bit more. So that's the reason that a lot of us don't get the tax break.
So there was no cost of living adjustment built in.
Is that what it is?
If it had a cost of living adjustment, it could have kept up. Right now, if you get a raise in your Social Security and you make $25,100, you're not eligible for it anymore.
Or your senior break.
I'm apparently invisible to you. You struck a nerve early with me, and I don't mean to be rude, but we are not a democracy. As a history teacher, I hope you will understand we're a republic. Okay. Now, you give the superintendent a bad review. What happens?
It's going to have to be a, and of course, I don't know, that's going to be based on a contract.
Give him a B minus.
Yeah.
What happens?
Nothing.
He got a B minus. Right. Next year, what happens?
I mean, it's going to be the same process.
Oh, okay, so you really don't have a lot of control, do you?
Unless you have some kind of criteria that says, you know, you must meet certain
criteria.
But you could put in.
I guess you could put it in a contract based on evaluation that you're not meeting,
but they don't sign the contract.
You've got to be able to meet per certain performance standards.
Yeah, I see that.
That's only common sense.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And I think part of the answer to your question, I think, would be the duration of the contract. You know, how long are we going to write this contract for? And what performance evaluation criteria are?
Let's do an example.
Yeah.
3-year contract.
Yeah.
The guy gets a B minus first year. Second year, he's a C. Do you just not renew the contract? Or you say, hey, you're underperforming, you're out of here. We'll get something new.
You have that capability. And I think if you look around surrounding counties, you can see that there have been situations where superintendents have not been renewed and or removed mid-contract. It's not something we want to exercise. It's not a power we want to go to, because it's going to cost the taxpayers money if we go that direction.
Well, because there's going to be... Well, how you write the contract with that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you say, okay, you don't perform well, we're going to give you $100,000.
Right.
That's on you. That's stupid.
Exactly.
So anyway.
But yeah, no, I know where you're going.
I'll go back in my home.
You're not those contracts, you know, and of course I don't like the long term contract. The contracts can be, once a contract has been written, let's say it's a 3-year contract, they're contracted for 3 years. And unless there is something that really breaks that contract, the performance part,
like
of that.
Like a performance clause?
A performance clause. And of course, we have that in, you know, that is part that we know what we're going to have out of the superintendent. It's very clear to us with this contract we have. And matter of fact, that's never been in place in the state until now. That contract, where there is a definite number that says your school district must meet this criteria, must, and to where there's an actual contract between every board of education in this state that puts your school district on the line like that. So that makes the selection of a school superintendent that much more important, because if you do a 3-year contract, which is a common, you know, term, and if you do that, you've got to have some serious guidelines there to make sure that they're meeting what we are held accountable to.
Yeah, you know, you've got to be able to terminate them for cause.
You do, and there is that. And that's a pretty common clause in there. But then, you know, making sure that you have the criteria, because we see it all the time, school districts who get rid of superintendents, and they pay them off. You know, you're paying them off in the middle of a contract.
And
a 3-year contract is, unless you set it up basically as a 1-year contract, because if it's 3-year renewable every year, it's not a 3-year contract. It's just a 1-year contract. And it's hard to get people on a 1-year contract for that position.
Well, and they're going to have confidence in their abilities, yeah.
I know, yeah, it's tough, that's tough.
Real quick on this. First of all, who helps you write the contract?
We have an attorney who...
Local?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was number one. And then number two, so why couldn't you put in the contract, if it's a 3-year contract, why couldn't you say that if we don't meet the 3% progress, then your contract is null and void, and any repercussions from that shouldn't hit the taxpayers?
Right.
I think those are things that we have to look at. Because like Daniel was saying, we're under a whole new world.
Yeah. You'll probably see contracts now that have never been written based exactly like what you said.
Yeah.
Because we are on that kind of accountability that you better put that. You better have something. And we're still looking. I mean, what you just said is something that we're going to take back and say, you know, and we probably will start researching other school districts' contracts to see if they're putting those stipulations in there.
Well, they should.
Absolutely, because we've never been, in my opinion, I've never known the school districts to be under that kind of accountability until now.
Apparently, you don't know the school lawyer that writes contract comes in very
non-controversial, and he's going to go along to get along.
Well, maybe we need a new one.
Yeah.
Would you be willing to publish the contract that's being offered to the superintendent before it's signed so that the taxpayers can see what's out there?
I don't know what legal rights we have with personnel. But, because these people are considered personnel, and I don't know what how the loophole is that makes that contract not...
I understand
that, too.
Get an answer on it.
I will, absolutely will. I'll look to see what stipulation, because I know the contract is not, it is not a, it's... I don't want to say it's a public document, but I guess it is available.
It should be if
it is available. So I don't know what stipulates. But I will find out. I'll ask what that means.
What's being offered to this person, and so people can say, hey, I saw this in the Pickens County newspaper that we're offering this contract. Why do we have all these little stipulations?
And I do know that we have to publish before the contract is final. We have to publish information about the. It'll be in Pickens Progress. And, I don't know. Does No Pickens put that?
They don't have. Because they're the legal organ. Nobody has to. I'll put anything you put up there, but y'all don't have to give me anything. Okay. You have to give it to the paper.
Yeah. Okay.
But
I'm curious as to why this lady and I have sort of. Looking at each other, she doesn't believe that a prospect will sign it.
Correct.
Why do you believe that?
Because I worked with a woman whose husband was a superintendent 30 years ago in a school district in Michigan, and he was making over $100,000 a year. And when he left and she retired with him, his retirement pay was close to $100,000 a year. And she would tell me all these things that he could do and couldn't do and what they would sign if they were going for a new contract. And most of the time, if they don't like something, they won't sign it. And if you really want that person, you're going to change the contract to get that person.
Well, it's certainly a negotiating process. We're not negotiating.
So did we ever offer these perks to other
employees?
Other
superintendents? The only person we hire is the superintendent.
And so the superintendent negotiates. Two other superintendents? Does anybody know?
I've got what was offered to the Atlanta Public School superintendent. I've got DeKalb County, Cobb County, Gwinnett. That's all. I could not find this information.
But we didn't do it here previously.
You mean ahead of time before it's signed?
No. I'm saying, did we offer previous superintendents the same perks that Lula May had?
I don't know. I was not on the board at that time, so I don't know what their contracts were. I know the dollar amount, but I don't know what the...
I want to kind of skip to slightly different subject.
You're paying tax
dollars? If you remember, I'm sure you do. Last summer, there was a little bit of a brouhaha about the... large increase of salary for something called a parent coordinator.
Yeah,
I looked up on OpenGov Georgia, and the average salary for a parent coordinator in Cherokee County and Cobb County is hovering around $27,000. And it was increased in Pickens County to $80,000 last summer. However, on OpenGov Georgia, as of 2016, which I looked up 2 days ago, it's now listed as $114,000.
What is that? That's outrageous.
Okay. We do not have anyone in that position at all right now, so I'm not sure what that's about.
Could I have that position?
I'll apply.
Yes. Pickens County parent coordinator.
What you're seeing right there, and of course, because sometimes personnel issues are not discussed publicly, go back and look at what you're seeing there was a position that person had prior to being in that. So you're seeing a salary that was not related to that position. And what I'm saying is, if you took somebody out of this position and they were making X amount of money, and you put them in this position and they took a cut, but at the end of the year they made that much for the year based on where they were, then that's what you're seeing there.
is what you're saying.
So you're saying it's wrong.
114 is completely wrong. I have no idea what they're talking about.
Well, y'all give, whoever gives the information to the state, put it in the database.
I have no idea what that's about, because that is incorrect information.
Then why are they making $80,000 and Cobb County is only paying $27,683?
I think what you'd have to look at is the job description, and we changed, when that position was, the salary was increased in that position, there was a complete rewrite of the job responsibilities for that position. And so we left the title, but not the job description. When that person left that position, the duplicate job description is gone now. And so we have not filled that position yet. When we do fill it, the salary will be based on the job description, not the title. Does that make sense?
No.
A snow job, it's a snow job.
And I'm trying not to do that, but there are some personnel issues that are confidential that I can't actually discuss. But it's like, okay, if I'm hiring the potato manager at the Kroger, then I'm going to pay him $20,000. When I add to the potato manager, also he's got to manage the dairy, the meat, all the other departments, then in fact, even though I didn't change the title of potato manager, I've changed what that person is responsible for. And so.
But you would always change the title.
Well.
And why wouldn't you change the title?
And so you're saying our superintendent has more responsibility than.
By the time the person left, that person was only in the position a very short period of time.
That's what it sounds like.
Well, she's talking about the, Anita's talking about the parent-teacher coordinator that was all that big groove. Wanting to give them $80,000 last year and everybody protested against it. And now according to the government website, it's up to $114,000.
I think the citizens here should check and see who got that position and who they're kin to. I think.
Anybody in this county.
Here's how to answer your question right here, because obviously that's a touchy area. Go to Pickens County Progress and go back on their, and do their, what do you call it, the archives. Pull that newspaper up that reported that. And then during that timeframe, go to the video of the Pickens County Board of Education meetings.
That has nothing to do with gov.
Yeah, it does. It will explain the situation that she's got.
That's what I would. Who gave you the number?
Could you find out?
Tell Jones, because he's the next one we're going to see.
Where do we find?
He'll just tell you it's up to the school board. That's his standard answer.
Job descriptions are, I guess, I don't know if job descriptions are on the hour.
I don't think they're on the website.
I think they may be.
You may have to do Owen's request record for it. That sounds awfully complicated.
Why would something like that be going on the website?
I think it is. I think it is. I think job descriptions are on. I can't say.
I got a question about.
Two superintendent questions. How many, one, how many applicants have you had so far? And two, it's what kind of, how extensive is your background check? You know, like, why did this guy only work there 6 months? Why'd he get fired from a job 3 years ago?
Right now, I haven't seen, we've seen a number a couple of weeks ago of how many applicants we had. It's been about 3 weeks, I guess. That's going to close, the application will close in about a week. And then we will have a meeting after that and see how many applicants are. Because you probably are, you know, I don't know how many do it at the beginning and how many do it at the end. We will have that number, and that number will probably come out, everything else can come out in the newspaper regarding that superintendent search. And you know, as far as the criteria, and I don't know if everybody here is aware of the survey that went out, or it's on a school website, it came out in the newspaper.
I think everybody.
That was addressing, you know, different criteria that you would like to have in a school.
But didn't really ask any.
Pointed questions.
It's just general.
Well, I had a question about the interim superintendent, Dr. Charles Webb, is he a resident of this county, or are you paying for him to have a house to live in?
No, we are not paying for his house.
Okay, so he's paying for his own house?
Yes, and he is, and he's interim. And he's basically on a 3-month, and then how, if it would be month by month based on how our superintendent search goes. And we want the superintendent search to go as fast as possible. And we want it expedited because I would like to see a superintendent in here before the end of this school year so they can get their foot in the door before having a new superintendent beginning at the, you know, first of the school year.
So I guess our main concern for being here is not to let this happen again.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Bottom line, and $10.
Absolutely.
We have to tighten our belts.
Yeah.
Or just asking you to help.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yes.
Absolutely.
I just want to know, the reason we even had to have an interim superintendent to start with is one of the ways that we slice, dice the budget. We have no assistant superintendent. And so when our superintendent, Dr. Perry, left, at Christmas, very unexpectedly, I might add, we had to do something. I mean, we had, legally, you have to have a superintendent in place. We had nobody we could move into that slot. And so that's why Dr. Webb was brought in as interim, because we had nobody that we could
pick. And we were in a pickle.
I understand that.
You weren't aware that she was leaving, even though the real estate agent told us that she was just signing a 6-month renewal because she wasn't staying?
How come you didn't tell us that?
We didn't know that.
We didn't get a free phone.
We absolutely did not know
that. I don't have her phone. So. No, but we knew. We knew that she was only signing a 6-month.
And that might have been something she
just
saw.
An extension.
We didn't know that. I didn't know that for sure.
Okay.
I had no idea.
Because
that was, to me, it put us in a very bad situation at that time, you know, to be without a superintendent. Mm-hmm. Because we don't have assistant superintendents here, we had nobody that could fill that position. So it created a very tough situation.
Are you entertaining any locals?
Every person local will get interviewed through this process.
Will
everybody local
the principals considered for a superintendent position?
It's an applicant. They don't have to apply. Anybody who applies locally will get an interview for the position.
What's the
criteria? Do you have to have a doctorate or a master's? Or do you even have to have a college degree?
Well, you want somebody that understands, you know, all aspects of your school system. Ideally, you do, but to have a doctorate, I absolutely do not. That's not going to be my first criteria to look at. Not writing that off, but that absolutely is not my first criteria. I don't care if it says that or not, you know. But they're going to have to be able to fit the bill, you know, and be able to know. And they need to be updated. They need to know current education and know that these things are happening to not just us, but every school district. And we will be able to tell that, you know, as these people come along. We're going to know, you know, it's like putting on, you know, you may try on a bunch of new shoes or all new shoes, but how many of them fit, you know, the best way? So we got to find that perfect fit to do what we got to do. And, you know, was able to deal with, you know, get out in the community.
Well, when you interview them, you kind of get a feel of them, too.
You sure do, yeah. It takes seeing somebody and talking to them, you know, as you ask them questions and how they answer. You know, are they responding because they think that's what you want them to say? Or do you genuinely get a feel for, you know, that?
And there will be a two-tiered interview process.
Well, we just want somebody that have a vested interest in this county, not somebody that, oh, Pickens County, where's that located? I'll apply for this job. That's, you know, we don't want
to be a stepping stone. We want somebody who's here for our community.
Right.
And I understand 100% because I'm right there with you. I had much rather see somebody. Hey, but I won't say that that's the only criteria. I wouldn't say I'd write somebody off because they wasn't. Because we know what we have to achieve, and we got to make sure we pick the right person. And they don't have to live here. I don't care if they live in Pickens County.
But you provide them a place to live.
No. I was not involved.
I know, in Little Bay Perry. What if he asked, okay, I'll take it for the $120,000 that she made, but you got to provide me with a house to live in. Are you going to say, no, that's not part of your contract?
I think those days are pretty, and I can't speak for every board member, but I don't think, I know I do not want to see that anymore. I do not want to get into negotiations like that.
I thought somebody was paying the school tax.
Yeah, amen.
Send the ball and call the next one in.
The thoughts of somebody being local is a positive. I mean, that's positive. I like that too, because they know the system that they're, you know,
leading. Knows the county.
They know
the community.
But that wouldn't sway, but it wouldn't have, I do like that thought. I do.
Well, do y'all know whether or not Lula May Parrot received a 1099 for all this unearned income?
I have no idea.
Oh, I'm sure she did.
Yeah.
Since I found out about the $6 million, all this other crap, this is peanuts. Okay? So
yes.
My feeling is, as a group, you know, we need to go after the $6 million.
Amen.
We need to, some way, somehow, get the laws changed or whatever else that those liberals put in there, where we can get our money back for the kids or the whatever else. And then maybe by then, or maybe if that could happen, then us old Fakakas wouldn't have to pay school tax anymore.
Yeah, well, that's a big deal.
My question is, the counties, surrounding counties, how much smarter are they than Pickens?
Yeah.
That they're putting in the same amount, but yet senior citizens are not paying school tax?
And the state has given Pickens County a grade of C and D. But yet, Pickens County is the ninth highest paid teachers in the county, but yet our schools are graded C and D. More money does not equal quality education.
When you're talking C or D, there's a difference in what's called school climate surveys, which can be skewed big time on a state level. When you're looking at what she's talking about right here, CCRPI, that's the numbers you want to look at for your county versus surrounding counties or any county you want to choose. That is the report card that primarily comes from how your kids are testing. That's primarily what the CCRPI. Now, there's other factors in there as well, but that is the number one thing, is the test scores of the kids. And it wouldn't be down in, but I know what you're talking about, because they send out surveys that go to school, that go to parents, and do you feel like your kid's school safe, and different things. And if somebody felt unsafe, they could give them a quick, you know, bad mark.
But and a lot that of bad marks up to get a C and D.
Well, it may be, and I'm not contradicting that, but that criteria is not based on what you said is how smart your kids are or not. That's not the criteria of that, what you're talking about.
Yeah, our most recent CCRPI scores, our elementary district score was an 80.6. Our middle school was a 71.4, and our high school was a 76.7. And I think what I don't have with me is the state averages, but that is either do you have the one that shows?
I don't have that.
We're very close to state average or above state average on all of those.
And those numbers, like an 80, for example, would be 80 out of 100 is what that is. And to compare it, that's what you would pull up. And you can do this on the Georgia
Daily website.
You can pull up every school district, individual schools you can pull up. So you can see how our individual schools, which we show these at every board meeting, you know, when these numbers come out. You know, they're very public numbers, and you want to see them go up. And that's the number that we're held accountable to with the state.
Those are the ones we got to have those 3% increases.
Yeah.
So those two gymnasiums and the two auditoriums aren't helping high school at all?
Well, high school numbers are typically going to be lower, but they'd be lower no matter what district you look at, you know.
Yeah. There's a difference between SLOST money and community money, and capital improvements come from SLOST money. And just so y'all know, because I was at high school when that new Performing Arts Center came in, it's absolutely beautiful and it's wonderful. But the reason for having that second gym doesn't really have to do with anything other than the number of kids who have to have PE. So it was an academic facility as well.
How many people in high school? How many kids in high school?
1,400.
I think
the county's only like 26,000 people.
They're all on Facebook.
Yeah, the whole county is 4,346.
Yeah.
4,346 is what students. I got. Students.
We're not making any effort to solve the problem at Kansas Middle School, what we're going to do with it.
Yes, we are. We are. We're making, we actually, we have started discussing, you know, what we're going to have to do there. And we went to Jasper Middle School, the interim superintendent and I did, and talked to the student advisory council there, which, you know, includes parents and includes some teachers as well. And basically got a feel for what they want, what they think. And then we're going to just keep carrying those conversations and present options, and because we want to hear from people, because you know when you are building a school of any kind, we will be long gone off the Board of Education, and that school is still going to be sitting somewhere. Yeah. So you want to make sure everybody within your community it knows what's happening, and you want to try to get as much consensus, and it makes sense because once you build it, it's there. You know, whatever you do is there.
Do we have enough students to warrant two middle schools?
Well, you know, we currently have two middle schools, and I could talk a whole nother hours about.
I ain't
got time. Yeah. But we are in that process of talking, and it's going to be a very open, what people's going to see and hear what we're discussing, because I'm telling you, I don't want people blaming me for 10 years after, you know, whatever we do there. We have to make sure it is in the best interest, because that school of ours has been there since 57.
I remember when they built it.
Yeah, so it's been there a long time, so we have to be very.
I wanted to address the gentleman's comments about the shortage of the $6 million, and Ms. Lewis's comment about we don't have it.
He's looking for it
now. About we don't have the industry. Now, I brought this subject up to Jasper's and to Jones. If the county would perform, or have it perform, an outside agency has to do it, a cross-county-wide reassessment of all property, we would more than make up for. If every senior in this county signed up for a tax exemption, doing a county-wide reassessment would more than make up for the lost money. I've tried to make them see that. Jasper said, well, it costs $300,000 to do.
And Jasper's wife is a retired school teacher.
Yeah, and I said, well, look at the money you could get. $300,000 is nothing compared to what you get back. Gilmer just did a reassessment last September. They got an additional $78 million in their coffers.
Wow. That's not a board that the taxes says you're more to do.
Well, no, not if the state makes them. The last one we had was in 2000, and the state made Roy Dobbs do it.
But it wasn't countywide.
Yes, it was countywide in 2000.
I understood we hadn't had a countywide one since I was young.
It was 2000. The state forced them to do it, and that's the last time we had one. And there are many people, if you go on my website and look at the county website, there are many people who are up in the higher echelons of this county who had their property reassessed or reevaluated since 2000.
Can believe it.
Mm-hmm.
If you haven't sold the house, no, it wouldn't be.
And the reason I started this Pickens Seniors for Change was because I was new to the county, and they kept going up and up and up, while my neighbors didn't change at all.
No, because if you don't sell, you don't sell your house, you'll go with your
old. I know. It didn't make sense.
Kind
of anyway, that's the reassessment would more than make up for a senior tax exemption. There's only 20% of the 29,461 people in this county that's senior over 65.
How many?
20% of 29,431.
6,000.
So that even, and there are some people, unfortunately, who do not want to send you tax exemption, and for the life of me, I can't figure out why.
They can pay double,
but they don't understand.
They're paying their way.
They don't understand that you have to sign up for it. It's not automatically given. They think once the senior tax exemption is passed, they have to get it whether they want it or not. But no, if you want to pay 100% of your taxes, go ahead.
Surely we're pushing upon you.
But don't penalize that poor old 70-year-old widow down the street whose husband just died and now her income's cut in half, but the taxes still keep going up.
Okay, is any more questions for us? Here,
I thought you answered all of them.
My address, my email address, and that's my telephone number. And yeah.
I just want to say one thing. I'd like to see maybe one or two of these type of meetings maybe twice a year. Because I find these more useful than the board meetings.
Yes.
It's a little more interesting to have a little more give and take.
Sure.
And,
And I like that too. I do.
Yeah, we could
have. That's the only way you're going to get.
This is not just useful. This is useful for everyone.
Right. And that's a big deal. Communication is a huge deal. And then finding out, because we could have, I'm going to tell you this here, and we have posted stuff in the newspaper about, especially this strategic contract that we signed. I mean, this was a big deal. This is the biggest decision I felt that has ever been made in this county based on that contract. And when we posted it, we had teachers come in, we as a board came in, and we had a person from the state that came up here to answer questions. I had a stack of stuff. And this is probably, she may have it archived. I think it was recorded. And at the questions, I sat there and asked that man about this contract. And we did not have people from the community that are listening. And I'm thinking, my gosh, this is the biggest decision that we as a school board are probably ever going to make. And we can talk about superintendent, that's a big decision. But when we contract our school district and say this is going to happen, that's a big deal, especially when you're reading through things that lawyers have written and you take a layperson like me trying to understand, you know, what does this mean? And you're going through dissecting every word to mean, okay, is there something hidden here? And you're, you know, trying to note it so you can question somebody smarter than you. It's a big deal. And for that, we had no community involvement at all. And it was in the newspaper. It was everywhere. And I was expecting to see tons of people and we saw nobody there. You know, but now that didn't change. I went in there with the same goal, no matter what. I was going to ask as many questions as I could during that time. But so it's hard to make, unless we do this, you know, and you do it through, you know, something like this, it's hard to get everybody. But somebody's got a ball game they're going to, they've got something they're going to, and it's hard to get people involved.
You got to get them in the pocket.
Hard to get involved. But I don't mind speaking to people, because I'm going to tell you everything I can. Yeah.
Before the meeting's over, I want to say that I've got to compliment the two of you on your courage on showing up tonight.
Yes.
And what we've heard here,
you can't be
comfortable. It's uncomfortable. It was. Because you want to make sure you answer stuff. And you know, I came from a family. I was by no means a rich kid. I had six boys in my family, and my mom could not work, obviously, when you got six kids in your family. And I had uneducated parents. So when people start talking about tax dollars, I watched my daddy work till he died. And he didn't have stuff, you know. So I understand when people are concerned about their tax dollars. So I go in, and I'm major concerned. Now, I will say this. We do have a chief financial officer in this school district that I am proud that we have. When we start selecting a superintendent, I'm not really concerned about their financial side, because we've got somebody in place that, boy, this lady looks after the dollars. She looks after those dollars. And so I'm proud of having her. And I would think that y'all would be too. If you've seen what we see from her, she is extremely good at her job.
We go line by line of a several hundred page document on our budget. We are the only school system, I think, in the state of Georgia that does that. We spend hours and hours, and she will explain every penny that's in that budget.
Over and over. Because I'm asking a question about everything on there, and she's saying, she's answering. And she's probably already answered it for me in the past, but if I don't remember it right off, I'm like, tell me this again. And she just tells me every time. And you know, she's been doing it for like 17 or 18 years. So everything to me is concerning, you know. So she just continuously answers my questions over and over and over and does it. When
if you get 70, you'd be more concerned about it.
Yeah.
What do y'all get y'all's way? If you see something in there that, hey, this is too much. I got a $43 million budget. People ain't going to put up with this. You need to lower it. Yeah. Y'all do that?
That can happen. But now keep in mind, too, that we are individuals of a five-person board. Mm-hmm. And maybe one is very vocal, and maybe the other people are not. And, I mean, we're in a five-person board, and majority rule. So a lot of times things are presented that not everybody's in 100% agreement with.
That's the product of the board.
Well, as individuals, as taxpayers, we can see some of the places where the budget can be cut. But I don't know, y'all don't do it, or you say you need this, you say you need that.
Let us know where your
opinion is. Yeah, let us see what you see, and then we will try to see it from what we see. And because we talked about this earlier, we get information that takes us months and months and months to process so that it makes sense to us. And I lay in bed from 3 a.m. I mean, I'm awake just about every morning at 3 a.m. worried about school stuff, you know.
When you're in here.
And you know, do what? You know, and so I always want to do enough homework to know that what I'm doing is making a difference.
One of the big questions was like Neva had. Check out that parent teacher coordinator or find out where they
are.
I'm going to check on that. I have absolutely no idea.
I know where that's coming from.
You do?
And it's,
I know.
That position came from another position. That money was not the money that was paid to that position. If you remember.
And by the way, just so you will also know, that parent coordinator position, a huge chunk of that salary comes from federal government. It's federally funded position.
And we currently do not have that position, and I personally want somebody in that position. And the reason I want a person in that position, is the fact that we have parts of our community that we need somebody from our schools that go in. And it's normally going to be school, it's going to be parts of the community or groups of people or individuals that do not have, the child does not have the home support that I give my kids. I'm not worried about my kids. I'll stay up till midnight every night and help my kids after work to make sure they succeed. But we have kids in our school district that do not have that support. Right. And we need people that goes out and says, what can I do? How can I help this grandma who's raising her kid understand what it means to get on a computer and help that child? So that is an extremely important position. I'm not saying that you got to pay tons of money for it, but that position, and maybe Cherokee County probably has more than one, and I could see that. I could see people because you've got areas within every school district that is a huge problem, and I see it, and it almost makes me sick to know that we got kids that, you know, parents are not involved enough. And we have to get out there, and a lot of times the parents want to be but don't know how to be, and it takes somebody going out and say, hey, what can we do to help you in this area or whatever, and that takes, it becomes very individual at that point. Yeah. So we do need that. And I'll say this to people, I got it right here, and this is completely out of school stuff, but I told I would ask this. In the morning, the George Mountains Hospice is going to be setting up for Mardi Gras. I don't know how many people, if y'all even know about the Mardi Gras they do here. And they are getting down to where they don't have a lot of volunteers to help. I'm going to be in here helping in the morning. So if anybody's able to come help, and you may have more questions, and we can work and you can ask questions at the same time. So I told them I'd ask.
Well, somebody spent a lot of time today undoing what was done today.
I haven't looked in there.
No, they usually
do a great job.
Oh, it's okay.
They're having a rehearsal.
Oh, something gone? Something
no,
missing?
No, they're rehearsing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
When I look around this room, it looks like most of these people are probably my age. Oh, where are the parents of all these children that we're paying to go to school? Why aren't they here?
Well, they're in the church. We're paying for it.
Well, they're here. This is for us.
How old are you?
63.
Look good.
Well, I told told Ms. Williamson I had a room that was all about 60 people, and it's just about to the tee. I was concerned.
Out of 1,000 emails that I sent out.
1,000 emails.
Yeah.
And I personally sent a request back. Every person who contacted us, I sent, once we established a date, I sent a personal email to that person just to make sure that they got
that was
it.
Good.
And, but I didn't have a clue. I didn't have a clue how many. But I did tell you, I said, well, I got room for about 60 people. And that's exactly
what I had no idea how many would show up. You know, I had it trying to get a group together.
I'm impressed because, like Daniel said, we send out stuff all the time. We're going to do this, that, the other. We get very little response. Yeah. This is the best response you've had.
Lee is a great organizer.
There you go.